And I was just getting to the end of the rope. My savings, everything was gone. You know, I was just like, God, please. I already had a job in Nigeria. I don't want to start calling family and disturbing them and saying, please, can you borrow me 1 month rent? Can you borrow me 2 month rent? You know, thing that, you know, played a part in me getting a job late was because I got into school on 22nd, which is when school had already started. And I found out that people, you could usually get a job if you come in maybe 1 or 2 weeks before. I remember going to my course advisor and asking him to give me a recommendation, and you know, it was just like, I don't know you, are you in my class? And in my head I was like, my life.
I began to see that these people actually released 2018 jobs, and I told you 2018 jobs, like 2017, and people started recruiting around that August. Different companies have different times at which they recruit, but for companies like Facebook, Google, and IBM, all these top companies, I think they started recruiting around that June, July, August, September, or October-ish kind of period. So I'm like, I began to see opportunities for internship next year, and I applied. I began to apply. I remember I got an interview. I won't lie to you. I got an interview, I think September, October of 2017 from Facebook. As in, I was shocked. Small boy from Nigeria. I didn't know I was good enough.
But let me borrow something from the scripture, you know, just a phrase that says, as far as your eyes can see. And I really believe that, you know, I really believe that, you know, in this case, I think people only plan as far as, you know, they can imagine, as far as they can envision, you know. And I think one of the things that helps people, that helps you, you know, envision something bigger than yourself, or envision something so big, big dreams, is exposure.
That was really good. I know some of the highlights you made mention of were really things that I did too, you know, networking and also making sure that I'm impacting lives while in school too. Those are important things. Mm-hmm. I want us to like delve deeper into like internships, jobs and opportunities too. So mm-hmm. What would you say about let me put it another way. What would you say about the importance of having internships while in school, especially as an international student? And maybe were you able to get internships? What do you think you could have done better in that instance?
Mm-hmm. So for internship, I didn't do any internship outside of school. And especially because, you know, I knew that if I get a job outside school, I would lose my graduate assistantship. But I was torn between, should I get a job and just pay my tuition myself, or just do the graduate assistantship? But I think now that I know better, I feel like I should have pushed Ada to get an internship, because I'll tell you this, it makes all the difference. It makes all the difference. Getting an internship while in school is important. It is, in fact, I cannot even stress enough how important it is, because it is one of the key steps to helping you get a job after school.
Yeah.
So just with friends that I've seen, or even some of my coworkers, I know some coworkers, you know, that I work with at Visa, who did their internship at Visa while they were in school, and then Visa just retained them, you know. So number one benefit of internships is you can get retained, you know, when you graduate.
Yeah.
So it means, you know, you don't have to start looking, or if you still want to look, it means you have options.
Yeah.
So that's the number one thing. And then number two is just, experience is key. I know friends who maybe did something else. They didn't do computer science in Nigeria, and then they came here and did MIS. But just because there's no experience to really tie, you know, to really tie into that MIS, into that field,
yeah,
really, you know, delayed them getting a job. So I'll say this, that having internship helps you get experience.
Yeah.
Before you go out there, I mean, it's key. You know, you get real life practical, you know, corporate experience.
I agree with you.
Like, you know, so Lola and I did studied management information systems in at Bush State University, if you guys haven't figured that out. So, and she was my senior. She graduated like a year after I did. And, you know, one of the things that I've seen, and, you know, these are people that I've looked at, in, like, especially Wally. He kept on making Wally. Wally was my first guest, and he was like my low-key mentor back then while in school. The first thing he narrated to me, it was narrated to him about some of the things he did, some of the things he could have done better and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And those things I took into consideration and said, I have to do this thing. And one of those things was securing an internship. So I came in August 2017 to start my program. Yeah. And Wally was like telling me that the following year you have to work towards getting an internship, because it is when you get an internship that you have opportunity of getting retained and getting full time. So yeah. What was I doing from August till let's say January or February? I was applying to jobs. And I think most people don't get these things. They don't get that they can secure internships, full time opportunities, even a year before you start the job. And I don't blame some international students like that. And the reason,
Information is key.
And I don't blame them, because where we come from in Nigeria, why would you get a job a year before you graduate or 6 months before you know. But thank God I was able to be like, you know, we talk about people getting information from people. And all my guests, they've always talked about networking and talking to people. So that is very key to success, no matter.
It is. Because, you know, the people you surround yourself with is really what determines the kind of content that you get.
Exactly.
You know?
Tola Thunder said something very profound. He said that you're only limited to the average information within your environment.
Exactly. No, I absolutely agree with that. I mean, like, you know, it is what your environment has to give up that it gives off, really.
Exactly. Or except you decide to go out of their environment and you know, get other perspective or different things.
Go outside your box, you know. Go outside the box, like spread yourself out, like, you know, you have to just go beyond what is minimum you can do. You have to like go above the maximum, and you have to seek out information, you have to ask questions. As I said again, the internet is a very good resource for everybody. Use the internet. There is information there. Know what is allowed and what isn't allowed. Know what is possible and what isn't possible.
Sorry to call you short there. It was through the internet that I kept on checking Facebook, Google, checking all this. Around August, September, October, I began to see that these people actually released 2018 jobs. And I told you 2017, 2018 jobs, like 2017. And people started recruiting around that August. Different companies have different times that would they recruit. But for companies like Facebook, Google, and IBM, all these top companies, I think they start recruiting around that June, July, August, September, or October-ish kind of period. So I'm like, I began to see opportunities for internship next year, and I applied. I began to apply. I remember I got an interview. I won't lie to you. I got an interview, I think September, October of 2017 from Facebook. As in, I was shocked. Small boy from Nigeria. I didn't know I was good enough. My interview was good enough. My resume was good enough. And somebody sent me a message from Facebook saying that, hey, we look at your resume, we think you're good fit. We're going to do an interview with you and stuff like that. And even though I was, when I got on the day of that interview, I got the call, and it was a coding interview. And I was supposed to do the coding, write something. I messed up, and the reason why I messed up was because on my phone I saw I think I saw something around California, something maybe a place in California or something like that. I just saw it and I'm like, wow, Facebook is calling me. And I was like anxious. I was like worried. Yes, they're calling me, coding interview and stuff like that. And the questions were so simple. The coding questions were so simple that I could have been passed it and stuff like that. But you know, it is what it is.
I can't even begin to stress. Internship is like a no-brainer. Do it. Like, look for the opportunity and do it. I mean, it will pay you off so much.
Yes, so it's going to.
I just want to say something because, well, I don't want to say everything about me right now because I know I'm going to share my story one of these episodes. So I will just leave it for now there so that you people now have all the juice that I'm going to be sharing later on. So, but generally, I'm going to share about how I got my internship and stuff because the truth is, I got my first internship 7 months when I came to the United States, 7 months. And it was because of Nesby, which I'm very sure Lola is going to share about it. Some of these things are doable if we can push. I think international students, and I don't know whether you agree with me, and I want you to speak on it. Few international students sometimes are scared to, I think they are too scared or too worried or too frightened that they cannot even make a step. Because they think like, who will hire us? We're international students. I've always been getting rejections. Who will hire us and stuff like that? I heard a lot of stories around that. Those stories were like, no, you can't get it. It's not possible. You can't get internships. But I did not listen to them at all. I was just doing my own. I don't know whether, how do you think we can solve that issue, especially when it comes to international students focusing on their present issues? You know, we are so embattled with our present issues that we don't think of long term. How do we solve issues long term? How do we, like, we're trying to, like, you know, just move as the day goes by, which is not bad, but we also need to think about the future. So what do you have to say about that?
I'll use myself as an example and just, you know, tell you what I think generally. I think, you know, this is a problem that we all face in one aspect of our lives where, you know, we can't, you know, plan way ahead. But let me borrow something from the scripture, you know, just a phrase that says, as far as your eyes can see.
As far as your eyes can see.
And I really believe that, you know, I really believe that, you know, in this case, I think people only plan as far as, you know, they can imagine, as far as they can envision, you know. And I think one of the things that helps people, that helps you, you know, envision something bigger than yourself or envision something so big, big dreams, is exposure. Exposure. You have to get out there so that you can know what is possible. I'll give you myself as an example. When I came here to the US, I was just like, I heard they have good jobs in the US, you know. And when I saw some of the other people who had graduated from Bowie, you know, some of them had, like, you know, from moderate to, you know, the people I knew who had, like, mega super great jobs were just maybe one or two, but some of them just had, you know, jobs with some companies here and there, you know, making some money. And in my mind, I was just like, if I can just, let's just even get one job that'll be paying like us like 40k per year, clinical per year, you know, like. But because to me, right, coming from Nigeria, I'm like, if I won't change that $40,000 to naira, man, that's a lot of money, you know. That was as far as I could see. But guess what, when I went to Nesby and I saw people, I saw the kind of companies that came, and they didn't discriminate that maybe you didn't go to an Ivy League school. They like they just want to know what you have to offer. What gifts do you have to offer the world? What value can you bring to the table? What problems can you solve? What is your attitude towards problem solving, towards life, you know? So it's just about what you have to offer. you know, and being exposed to know what's possible. So when I got to Nesby and I saw my mates going to front of the big company, I said, wait. It's like, wait, I just wrote down all the big companies I wanted. Google, Apple, Facebook, Microsoft, Visa, you know. I started going to them and talking to them about my skills, my previous experience, and just when I saw people's resume, because I was, you know, of course I met some other people. I saw one of my friends, I'd already done internship with
Boeing.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to say. So, you know, another friend had done internship with Microsoft, and when they were telling me just, you know, the kind of treatments, I was like, wait, so what was I doing with my head? But guess what? If I hadn't gone to that, you know, event and experienced people who had done these big things, like, it's possible. You know, again, that's why I said, as far as your eyes can see. And your eyes can only see, you know, just as far as your mind is open to. And it's exposure that opens our minds. Where you've been, who you've interacted with, your experiences, the experiences of other people you've learned from, the books you've read. So again, exposure is key. Get out there, because that's when you know what is possible, what is doable. And then when you know what is possible, add taxes, because the sky is the limit. You can always go even farther than what people have done.
Wow, wow, this is deep. Oh, you are really dropping some gems for us. Oh.
No, seriously, but because that's how you do it. Like, coming to this country and just experiencing these things, it has opened my mind. Like, now I feel like I can do anything. In fact, now I just tell myself that anything I want to achieve that I can't do is just because I'm lazy and I don't want to do it.
See, I think we should just end the interview there. Yes.
You can do. Well, they will say no. Yes. They will reject you. Yes. But guess what? It is doable.
It is doable.
Because as long as you have something to offer, there are people in the world who have a need for that thing that you have to offer.
Yeah.
So it's just about, you know, making that match.
Yes.
You know, one of my guests, Wally, again, he kept on saying that he applied, he said he did, I mean, over 200 applications before he was able to get his job at John Hopkins. And I was like, how can you do that? Why would you do that? He said that no, he said he knew there was something out there for him, something cool. He wasn't giving up, and because he knew he was exposed. He knew that my friends are doing this and they're getting it, and I can also do stuff like that too. Man, it's actually, as far as you can see, I totally agree with you. Now I want you to tell us how you were able to get your job, your full-time job. Like how was it?
So just to share my experience, I mean, I remember when I was going to, you know, preparing for Nesby, honestly I wasn't very prepared because I was having issues with one of my courses in school. It was just giving me issues. I felt like I was going to fail that course, and you know the professor, exactly, the professor that was not mentioned. But yeah, I mean, I felt like
my friend,
anyway. Oh my
God. Yeah. He actually misses me sometimes. There was a time I went to Bowie for PWC something like with like recruiting and stuff like that. So I went there and we had this talk. It was so he said he missed me. I was like, really? Is this his person? Is this person? So continue, sorry for cutting you short.
No problem. Yeah, I mean that professor, you know, that we must not mention, you know, just gave me hell when I was graduating, and it was difficult. I felt like, man, God, I can't fail, you know, like, I mean, I always had my A's and everything, but this one was just like, you know, I wasn't getting it, and I was exhausted because, you know, I'd been through like 4 semesters of school already. It was my 5th semester, so I did my master's in 5 semesters, so you know, it was things were already, you know, like overwhelming for me. I didn't have time to edit my resume, but I had gone to this resume building session I told you about, and I just left it at that point where it was, you know, and just whatever was on my resume that day was what I took to NSB. I remember my friend Wole calling me maybe a week or two before saying, a week before saying, okay, Lola, are you prepared? I said, I'm just trying. Told me, have you started applying for jobs? I was like, all my ass, it was just no. But he just told me, okay, he said, you know what, you need to, you know, make sure everything is ready. And then he told me, do you know what you're going to pitch? You know, like, what position you want and everything. And I told him, I said, yes, that, you know, based on my experience, you know, I know what I want to do. I had already done some previous research to know the kind of roles that fit the skills and the experience that I already had. So
one thing that is so essential is knowing the path forward, like knowing what you want to do. Because the IT field is like wide. Yes. So you need to know, like, you need to have a purpose, like, or an idea of, okay, this is the role that best fits me and stuff like that. So, yeah. And your experience also really helped you out, I guess. Like,
yeah, I knew what I wanted. I knew what I loved doing, you know. So, you know, like, I know that I love puzzles. I love logical reasoning. And I love, you know, just putting things together, making processes better and everything. So, I knew that I always wanted to be, you know, a systems analyst. I wanted to just look at the system and pinpoint and say, okay, this we can do better, this we can take out, this we can add. You know, that's what I enjoy doing. But, you know, doing it in a tech environment and just doing it and seeing how it just improves things so much. I mean, that's what gives me joy. So I knew what I was going to pitch there. So, but I mean, I got my elevator. Always have your elevator pitch ready. See, always. And that was something I also learned from the dean of business school when I was organizing one of these career events for him. You know, he just told me, get your elevator pitch ready. I went to Google, which one is elevator pitch? And then I saw, you know, that, you know, it's just basically a summary of your education, your experience, your skills, and your strong, you know, your strengths. And so, you know, I got everything ready. But in terms of resume, I honestly didn't do anything. I was just like, man, I'm so tired. So I remember getting to NSB the next morning. All my friends had already gotten, you know, they did this Apex verification. But because I wasn't even in the right state of mind at the time, I didn't even do it. So everybody were getting inside before me. But I was like, hey, God. You know, I was a bit, you know, just not in the right state of mind that morning. And then I was panicking. I started looking at my friend's resume. I was like, yeah, everybody's resume looked like, you know. And so I rushed to the career center and I was like, please, I need to edit my resume. I remember just sitting in front of the computer that day and looking at it that, wait, what do I want to add? So at this point, I can't even think. But I remember that I had, you know, I just taken a course in school where we took IBM Watson Analytics. So I was like, wait, I can put that on my resume. And I just put it, you know, the part where I had my skill set, I just put IBM Watson Analytics there. I was like, well, at least I did it in school last semester and I actually know how to use the tool, so might as well just add that one. That was the only thing I was able to add. And I just closed the resume and then went back up, you know, and we started getting into the building where the companies where, you know, I met with different companies. I remember writing down all the big ones I wanted. I wrote down IBM, Dell, you know, wrote down Accenture. I always liked Accenture from Nigeria. I always wanted to work in a consulting firm, you know, because, you know, all those Lagos big girls then, I worked with Accenture. So Accenture was on my list, but unfortunately, I think because Accenture didn't do visa sponsorship, that was another thing on my mind. You know, I made sure the companies that I went to, first thing I asked them was, you know, do you do visa sponsorship? Because, you know, of course, I'm an international student and at some point we'll need visa sponsorship. So definitely asked them that. And, you know, I went to Microsoft, I went to Visa, I went to Apple, you know, I went to about 10 companies that day. It was exhausting because you're on your feet the whole time, walking around, talking to these companies. And I remember my encounter with Visa. It was like every other encounter, but I just remember, you know, talking about my skill set. You know, I was like, I have database experience, I have this. And I remember the recruiter I spoke to just writing things down on my resume. Okay, you have this, okay, you have that, okay. And then just wrote everything down. I also remember, you know, getting an interview with Microsoft for the next day. So it was supposed to be, when they sent me the email, it was supposed to be for like a cloud infrastructure type of position. But then when I got to the interview, the person that wanted to interview me said it was for a software engineer position.
Wow.
For coding. And I knew, so that's another thing, know what you don't want to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so I told him, I was like, I don't, you know, this isn't where my passion is. And, you know, I don't think I'm going to be great at this thing. And I know sometimes they always say, oh, go for it. But, you know, like, I knew, I was certain in my mind that, you know, this isn't where I want to be right now.
Yeah.
You know, and that's one of the things that comes with, you know, just being sure of a clear path that you want to follow in your career. You can lead up to, you can build up to something else. You can say, okay, maybe I want to, you know, become maybe a CISO, you know, but first I'm going to start with maybe GRC or start with something, you know, just have a clear path, you know. And even if you don't have a clear path, know your strengths.
Yes.
And know your weaknesses. Seriously, I mean, you don't even have to have the next 10 years planned out, but just know what your strong points are. And, you know, and I told him, I was like, see, I have a bachelor's in computer science, but, you know, I never had a knack for programming. It's not something I feel that I will excel at. You know, I was pretty sure about that. And, you know, just remembering why I did MIS again, it was just me wanting to bring technology and business together in the middle ground.
Yeah.
You know, to translate the language of technology to business in a way that they understand it. You know, that was where my passion was. So I just, you know, I told him, he was like, I really like, you know, how you're speaking. I really want to work with you, but, you know, think about it. And he gave me his contact details. It was like, if you change your mind and feel like you want to start coding, text me, hit me up. I was like, great, I will. You know, so that was the only interview I did, you know, there. I got a call from Apple and they said they were going to get back to me, but I never heard back from them. So 2 days after Nesby, I was feeling discouraged, and I remember telling Wale and everybody I could tell back in school. I was like, man, we don't know anything in our school. Like, we don't know anything, because, man, I saw people talking about internships, you know, people who were talking about previous experiences they've had. I was like, man, what are we doing? Like, we need to get our shit together. But, like, you know, I told my friend Wale then, and even he agreed. We were like, man, we need to do better. We need to organize more career, you know, planning events at Bowie. You know, we saw places where we needed to improve.
Yeah,
and
wow,
you know, it was 2 days after Nesby actually that I got a call back from Visa. You know, like, the whole thing was already over, and I was just depressed that nobody cuckoo gave me job, you know. But, you know, I got a call from Visa, from a recruiter, saying, hey, I shared your resume with one, you know, with the hiring managers, and one of them actually wants to have a further conversation with you. And that was beginning of it. You know, it spanned over like a few months. I remember I got my offer letter May 13th,
wow,
2018.
And your graduation was
May 22nd. May 22nd.
Yeah. Wow, that was a good news.
Yeah, I mean, it just, you know, it took away all the stress I was feeling from school. Like, it took away everything. So, you know, immediately the interview started. I talked to the hiring manager. And when I spoke to the hiring manager, I just felt like we connected on what our passions were in IT. You know, so it just...
It's easy for you because this is what you want.
Exactly. So, and that's what I'm passionate about. So we just kind of clicked.
There's no need to fake it. There's no faking.
Yeah, and it felt that, because we were just like completing each other's sentences, like, oh yeah, oh true, you know, like, it was just, it was, and I felt positive about it. And when we were even talking, I hadn't even seen the job description then. So they just sent me the link after that conversation. Immediately I saw that job description, I was like, this is what I want to do. I was like, this is exactly why I came here to study MIS, process improvement in technology, you know. And it was great. You know, I had interviews with about six more people after that. I had one with the recruiter, one with the hiring manager, and then two with two senior directors in the company. And then the next one, I was actually flown to California, you know, to the headquarters where I met the team. You know, I got interviewed by the VP, and then I met my manager in person. It was amazing. I remember, you know, when I wanted to do the in-person interview, I bought a new shirt, a new Calvin Klein shirt. You know, I was like, I have to look good. Even though they told me, you don't need to dress corporate or look, because it was like a casual type of interview. But I was like, man, I will look my best to this interview. You know, I did everything, looked great. And then I remember the previous night, I was looking at the mirror, you know, at the hotel where they lodged me, you know, just answering questions. Okay, tell me about yourself. How will you answer? It's funny thinking about it now, but I was already practicing, you know, how my face will be, my countenance. I watched so many YouTube videos of, hey, how to do in-person interview. Oh my God. Those videos, very helpful. You know, behavioral questions. I read about how to answer behavioral questions using the pattern of, okay, what happened, what you did, and the end result, you know, just... resources, just go look for resources online. You know, I read about visa, you know, and I remember, guess what? At my in-person interview, one of the people that interviewed me, guess what the person asked me about? IBM Watson Analytics that I put on my resume on the day. That was the only, the person said, we're about to start a project at visa, you know, and we're actually planning to use IBM Watson Analytics, actually the IBM suit, and they just want to know, you know, what I know about IBM Analytics. They were like, you know, don't just tell us what you know. And you know, I told them about class project. We did the Titanic project then, you know, analyzing what happened in Titanic. I'm sure you're familiar with that, you know, that case study. So I told them about that, and they were like, oh yeah, that's great, you know, like, you told me everything I needed to know. And that was how that one just went great. So you know, I mean, it was a great interview. It was, I felt relaxed.
The thing is, in short, you were prepared for it, and you it's first and foremost, it's what you wanted, the job you wanted, and you didn't take it for granted. You researched about it and you did a lot of stuff about it. So you gave it your best shot, that even if you did, even if it didn't work out well, maybe it wasn't just meant for you, meant for you. And that's what matters most, especially as an international student. See, not everybody will be able to get a job in the country if you want to stay here, back here, but the most important thing is to give it your best shot. And one of the things why this program is important to me is I figure out that most international students, like this project, this interviews I'm conducting, I figure out that most international students don't give in their best shot. They don't really talk about, like, they don't really go for it, and they probably, because they don't have information, or because they feel like it won't work out at all and stuff like that. And that is always very, very important. I'm so glad that you gave your best shot. I want us to be running up little by little, and one of the things I want us to you to talk about is, like, looking back, what would do you think you could have done differently? Maybe like 1-2 minute conversation around that.
Yeah, I mean, looking back, what I could have done differently, I think, would be, you know, network more, you know, from the beginning, because I didn't start the networking until, mostly because I was focusing, as you said, sometimes you focus on the struggles. I was focusing more on finding a job to pay my bills, you know, and kind of abandoned my academics a bit. So I think I would have focused more on just networking and going to events and just even doing things outside school. I think also I would have even been more involved in school work, you know, just participate more in class, Because one course where I got a B, you know, my first semester, I realized that the only thing that was missing was just the professor just didn't see me participating in class. You know, thought I was, and this was from a conversation that I had the opportunity of having with the professor later. So, you know, so yeah, I think, you know, just being more involved, you know, in school things and things outside of school, I think that could have been better.
And to round up your what you just said, I think one thing that is also very important is when I came here, I think I quickly got something that the next 2, 3, 4 of years, next let's say 3 years of me being in this country, I have to work really, really hard. I have to work harder than people that are already here, people that have green card, people that have citizens, they're already citizens, you know. You know, I have to work harder than them because I'm not just a minority, like being black, but I am an international student. You know, there's one between being a minority and you being having the citizenship. International minority. So I figured I needed to double my hustle. So I really stressed myself in school. I was on two ends, focusing on my present circumstance, my struggle, trying to get bills paid. And number two, trying to make sure that by the time I finish school, before I finish school, I have at least one job offer. You understand? So I totally agree with you. On that.
And also, I think I would have, you know, fought more to get an internship, definitely. Yeah, yes. And you know, the last thing is, I would have been even more involved in class projects than I was, because. Yes. Now, some of the things we did back in class projects that you know, I learned from class projects, they are playing out in real life. Like, those things are real, you know, like they are practical things. So, you know, please get involved.
I totally agree with you. Ah, wow, this is so great. This has been a great interview so far. Like, thank you. I won't let you go on until you talk about what you are currently doing in Visa. What is your day-to-day kind of job? I know some of these things are confidential, so you won't want to tell us, but you can just be first.
So currently I work, you know, designing solutions for HR systems. So when I started at Visa, I worked in GRC, Global Risk and Compliance, for a year. So, you know, basically working with risk and compliance applications, you know, designing solutions for stakeholders in that area. But due to a reorg in the company, you know, I was moved to HR technology. So that's where I'm at right now, designing solutions for HR, you know, just using HR data to make more informed decisions and thinking about how we can use technology to improve human resources and employee experience in the company. And it's such an interesting thing because I didn't know anything about HR like that. I just thought it was just hire people, fire people, pay people. But you know, there's so much more to HR. Yes. You know, there's so much more to HR. I mean, like, even the effectiveness of a company relies on the kind of people that's hired in the company. So, you know, it's opened my eyes. And just because HR technology is just becoming something that, you know, using technology in HR is just now becoming a thing. You know, before stakeholders didn't want to spend money for tech in HR, but now they're starting to see just how important technology is in, you know, these different industries. So now, yeah, exactly. So
that's good. Now, you're having fun making the money and enjoying it. We know who's making more money anyways. By God's grace, we know who's making more money anyway. So last one, like, what would be your advice, your parting words?
Yeah, I just say, you know, for anyone coming, you know, planning to come here to study, or you're already here and you know it's like things are just tough, I'll say, you know, stay the course. Things will get rough before they get better, but it gets better. Take it from me. Like, it will get better. Just keep doing your best. Keep doing what you're doing. Things will get better. I'll say, have a plan and pray, you know, because, you know, this country is like, you know, it works with a system. America is very, you know, systemic, so you kind of have to have a plan, you know, and, you know, kind of know what you want to do next and plan your next move type of thing. So, you know, I'll say there's, of course, agreeing I'm a Christian, there's the human factor where, you know, we're planning, and of course, there's also God factor. So you have to pray and just, you know, align your plans with God's plans. But yeah. Planning is key. I'll say information is probably one of the most important things ever. Information and the people you surround yourself with is one of the most important things ever. So please get knowledge, get information, read books, read things online, know what you can or can't do. You know, and I'll say as much as possible, if you get any opportunity to participate in like practical experience in corporate America, please take it. Internships, you know, maybe one day experience where the company invites you over, you know, and you can see what their day-to-day is like. Please take those opportunities and, you know, just participate. And, you know, my last thing would be, don't be afraid to ask for help. I mean, we all don't like to hear no, I can't help you. Nobody likes to hear no, but you know, I think that a lot of people suffer a lot from just not being able to ask for help.
Yeah.
You know, so, and of course, even I have experienced a lot of hardship just because it was difficult for me to ask people for help. And people will always come to you to ask you what you need. So that's why you need to open up. There are always people willing to help. You know, just it is what it is. We all need each other to succeed. So
that's true. That's true. Thank you so much for your time. We finally did it. We finally made it. Honestly, oh my God, yeah, we finally made it. I'm so glad. And this is so far very interesting. Like, I hope people at home, like people watching this episode, like really, they probably picked out one or two things that will help them in their journey. Because the truth is, I keep on saying this, the fact that I am where I am is because of information people that I've always rely on, talk to, especially God is a very, very like big factor in my life, like God's grace. I'm a Christian too, I do not take for granted, but also God has also placed people around you to help you to grow and to get to where you need to get to. You don't want to abuse that, and I want you to always network and ask questions when you can, ask for help when you can. I'm pretty sure that you people have learned a lot right now, and I'm so glad that you guys were able to tune in to this episode again. I really want you guys to follow us on Instagram if you haven't, at tellyourstory.tv, on Twitter at tellyourstorytv, and also subscribe to our YouTube channel at Tell Your Story TV. Please and do like, share these videos. I'm very sure you people will find one of two things that have been helpful to you guys. I'm passionate about this project, and I believe that this project will be of help. Thank you so much, and God bless. Till next time, I see you guys on another episode. Cheers, bye.